Hello everyone. So this time in UGC NET July examination, there were many questions that were asked from Java programming, as well as there were some questions that they asked from JavaScript also. So the previous videos and the previous course, I have never covered this Java programming in the course because it was not mentioned in the syllabus. See, the biggest problem with the UGC NET examination is that even though the pattern has changed for the examination, even though how the exam is conducted, that is also changed, but they have never updated the syllabus of examination from a very long time. So that is why you are not sure that from which subject they are going to ask questions. They are asking questions from Java as well as JavaScript as a part of, you know, the object-oriented programming techniques. So now this time I am covering Java entirely from beginning till the end, as well as I am also going to cover the JavaScript for the UGC NET examination. But the thing is, I'll be covering more content as compared to what is going to come in the examination. So I'll tell you which topic that you have to study and what are the topics that you can leave for the examination. Okay, so I'll be covering the Java in more details, in lot of depth. So even if you are not preparing for the UGC NET exam, still you can prepare for Java. Still you can read the entire course of Java because that is going to help you professionally in your career. So the topics that I'm going to cover in Java, they are as follows. So number one, I'm going to cover the language fundamentals. Language fundamentals. Secondly, I'm going to cover the operators and assignments. Operators and assignments. The third one will be declaration and access control. Declaration and access control. Then the fourth one will be the flow control methods. Flow control method. The fifth one will be the exception handling. Exception handling. Then the sixth one will be the assertions. The next chapter here that I'm going to cover is object-oriented concepts in Java. The eighth one is inner classes. Inner classes. The ninth one will be threads and concurrency control. Threads and concurrency control. The tenth topic will be the fundamental classes in Java. The fundamental classes in java.lang.package. And the 11th topic that I am going to cover is the collections and framework. Is the collections and framework and generics. And generics. Then the 12th topic is file IO and serializability, that is serialization. The 10th topic will be, 13th topic will be the garbage collection. Garbage collection. And the 14th topic will be the new features that is added in Java. So whenever I'm covering any topic, for example, let us say I'm covering the topic which is language fundamental. So I'm going to use some notes that I'll be writing. So for example, these are the notes that I have written for the Java language fundamentals. So if you want to download these notes, you can go to our website, that is digimentor.com. Over there, go to the download section and you can find a PDF copy of the same document, of the same notes that I'm going to use. So, but my recommendation is that you create your own notes, because that is going to help you to retain the things more for your exam preparation. Now, the topics that I'm going to cover, all these topics are not at all necessary for the UGC NET examination, because these topics that I'm covering, that is too much in depth, that is not at all required for the examination. But I'm going to tell you what are the topics that you can skip and what are the topics that you can study. But thoroughly, I'm going to cover the entire Java course also. So that is your personal choice, whether you want to read the entire course or whether you just want to go through some specific topics only. Okay. So the first chapter that we'll be doing is we'll be starting with the Java language fundamentals. And here in the language fundamentals, I'm going to discuss about the basic operators. For example, how can you create an array? What are the variables in Java? For example, you must have studied the integer, character, float, and what are the different kinds of variables in Java. And a part of this, in case of Java language fundamentals, I'm also going to cover some of the new things that is introduced. Right? So let us start. So the very first chapter here is the Java language fundamentals, and the topics that we are going to cover in the language fundamentals. So it is language fundamentals, and the topics that we are covering here is, number one is identifiers. The second topic will be keywords, data types, after data type I'm going to cover literals, arrays, and then after arrays I'm going to cover the type of variables, types of variables, and the where arg method. So the very first topic that we are starting here is the identifiers. So what is an identifier? So identifier is generally considered as a name in the program. For example, it can be a name of a class, it can be a name of a method. Now that will be called as an identifier. So whenever I'm saying something, I mean, I suggest you to create notes for it. So please write it down. A name in the program is called as an identifier. A name in a program is called as an identifier. It may be the class name or method name or the variable name. It may be the class name or the method name or the variable name, or you can say a label name. A label name is also considered as a name in a program. Now for example, whenever you write a program, let us say I want to create a class, so I just say class Himu, and here in this class I'm going to create a method. So let us say that it is public static void main string arguments. Okay, and then here we have a variable which is integer x is equal to 10. Okay, and here this public is small. Now if we have a class like this, now in this class, a part of this, whenever I'm writing the name of this method, there is a main that is also a identifier. Now here we are using string argument. Here string argument is an array. So this args, that is argument, it is the name, that is why it is an identifier. A part of this, I'm using the integer x. Now this integer x is also a name, and it is also an identifier, and here generally this string is also considered as an identifier. So why this string is considered as an identifier, I'll also tell you why it is considered as an identifier. But you can see, whenever we write a program like this, class himu, public static void main, string argument, integer x is equal to 10. So this is a very general structure of a Java program. So everything in Java that will be that you are going to write, that will be enclosed within a class. So Java is considered as a pure object-oriented programming language. If you see in case of C++, in case of C, we were not having any concept of classes. But in the last, in C, when we studied C, we created something called as structures. Structures can be any combination of variables and, different kinds of variables. And now, in case of C++, C++ is just an implementation form of C language. So in case of C++, we incremented C and we added more new feature to C language, and that there's an extension of you know, structures in C++ that is called as a class. In case of structure, we can just include the variables, but variables as well as, you know, arrays, something like that. But in case of C++, these structures again are, you know, they are enhanced and they created, they form something called as a class. Now there are new features in the class that they included. Number one is inheritance, as well as we can also write methods in a class. We can also create access specifiers to those methods. We can also create access specifier to various variables like that. But in case of C++, it was not at all necessary. It was not at all mandatory that we have to write every method, every function inside the class itself. But in case of Java, it is necessary, it is important that you have to write every method, whatever method you are going to write, that method should be inside a class. That is why Java is called as a pure object-oriented programming language. Java is called as a pure object-oriented programming language. Now here, this is the name of the class. That is why this is acting as an identifier. This is a name of a variable, which is of type integer. In the same way, this argument is of type string. You can say it is a string array, and this is the name of the method, which is the main method. Now there are various rules that you have to follow while writing the name of the identifiers. So all those rules that will be flashing in front of your screen. So the rules are as follows. A Java identifier is a sequence of characters where each character may be a letter from small a to small z, or capital A to capital Z, or a digit from 0 to 9, or a currency symbol that is dollar or connecting punctuation. If you are using any other symbol, we get a compile time error called as illegal characters. Illegal characters. The second rule is that identifier should not start with a digit. So whenever you write the name of an identifier, for example here, you are writing the name of the identifier as x. X is an identifier. So if I write the name of variable, so it can be int x9a. So this is a valid name of an identifier, correct? Name of identifier can start with a character. But if I say integer 9xa, now this is not a valid name of an identifier. The name of the identifier cannot start with an integer number. In the same way, whenever we write in terms of class only, for example, if I say class hemo, I can write an integer here, class hemo 9. So that is perfectly fine. So the identifier can contain an integer, but identifier cannot start with an integer. So if I write 2 hemo 9, so because here this identifier name is starting with an integer, that is why it is not a valid identifier. So identifier cannot contain an integer number in the beginning. The second case is, in case of identifiers, you cannot have space. Identifiers can have a dash marks. For example, I can say integer hemo space xyz. Now this is not a valid name of an identifier. Why? Because it is containing space here. So space character is not at all recommended. You cannot use it. But you can write something like this: integer hemo underscore xyz. It is perfectly fine. If I write integer hemo minus xyz, the dash xyz, so this might not be correct, because this minus sign can be mistook as a subtraction sign. So that is why we have we have rules for creating identifiers. Now you can also use some special symbols in case of identifiers. For example, we have a dollar as a special symbol. So I can write integer hemo dollar. So that is perfectly fine. I can write integer dollar underscore hemo. That is also perfectly fine. It is also a correct identifier. But again, we cannot start with an integer number. A part of this, what are the rules that the identifier has to follow? So there is no length limit for Java identifiers, but it is not recommended to take more than 15 length. So you can create identifier with any length. You can create identifier with the length, with the length of this variable name can be 50 characters, 50, 100, 200. There's no limitations whatsoever. But the thing is, the long, if you are going to create long names of the identifier or long, the identifier length will be long, then it will create problems for you while you are going to write that identifier name in your program. So generally it is recommended that you should use the name of the identifier as a very small name, which should be actually less than 15 characters. That is recommended because that will create your programming more easy as compared to before. And the thing is, and the next rule is that Java identifiers are case sensitive. For example, if I write something like this, integer himu, himu, where h is capital, and I write integer himu, where h is small. So names both are same, but the thing is, here I am using a character h capital, here I am using a small character. So in case of Java, the identifier names are case sensitive. In the same way, for example, when you will write program, you will see that, for example, here I have written public as p as capital. So if I write p as capital, now it might return you an error, because even the name of the identifiers and even these names, they are case sensitive. So Java, in Java, whenever you write an identifier, whenever you write a name, it is case sensitive. So it is recommended that you use a specific case only. For example, here, if I write a program something like this, this is class ABC, and I'm writing public static void main, okay, and I'm writing integer himu is equal to 9, and I'm writing to print something, whenever I'm printing small himu, okay. So to print something, if I try to print small h, in that case, it will return an error. It will return an error. It will say that this identifier does not exist, or you cannot he cannot identify this particular identifier. So to print, generally in case of Java, I just wanted to skip, but still in case of Java, we use system.out.println to print a line. A part of this, you can just use system.out.print. That is also working. You can also use printf, so that will be system.out.printf, and you have to use a specifier which is %d %c. That is also working, that I'm going to cover in the later periods of time. But here you just have to understand at this moment of time that whenever you write in the name of an identifier, now the name of the identifier is case sensitive. If you write capital H and small h, it will consider them as two different identifiers. So always, always whenever you're writing a program, please note this down, that you have to work with it, okay? Now, I'm writing some of the names here on the screen. You tell me which of the following is a valid identifier. So the first identifier I'm writing is total hash. So you can see on your screen and tell me which one is valid. The second is all at the rate hands. The third one is 123XYZ. The fourth one is break. The fifth one is string. The next one is total number. The next one is dollar underscore dollar. Then we have dollar underscore CA dollar H cache. Now tell me which of the followings are valid identifiers. So as you can see, I've already marked them onto the screen, which is valid and which is not valid. Now you understand what is an identifier. You know, identifier is something that is the name of a variable, that is the name of a class, that is the name of a method, that is called as identifier. Now the next topic that we have to study here is about the reserved word, because there are some identifiers, that some name of the identifier that you cannot use. Now those names are called as a reserved word. So I'll just write a list of the reserved word here. Now some of the identifiers are reserved to represent some kind of functionalities. Now the word that is reserved for those identifiers is called as a reserved word. Now for example, if you have studied C language also, in C language there are some certain specific words that you cannot use as the name of a variable. For example, you cannot use if as the name of a variable, you cannot use else as the name of a variable. In the same way, you cannot use int as the name of a variable. So in the same way, in case of Java also, there are so many reserved words that they have used that you cannot use as the name of the variables. Now these reserved words are actually categorized into two different categories, and there are total 53 reserved words that we use in case of Java. And the first category is the keywords, where we use 50 reserved words. And the second category is the reserved literals, which are total of 3. Now, in terms of again keyword, there are two types of keyword. Number one is the unused keywords, and the second one is the used keywords. In case of unused keyword, we have go to and const. But in case of used keyword, we have keywords like if, we have keywords like else, we have keywords like for, we have keywords like while. These are the keywords that we used very frequently. In the same way, we have keywords for data types. For example, you have integer, that is int, we have short, that we have byte, we have double, we have character, we have boolean, we have long. We cannot use these keywords as a name of the identifier. A part of this, the keywords can also get categorized in one more category, that keyword for flow control. For example, we have if, else, switch statement, do statement, while statement, for, break, continue, return, as well as default. You cannot use these names as the keywords. So whatever the keyword that is flashing on your screen, please make sure that you are writing notes for it, because it will be more convenient for you while you are revising these topics. Now, there are also some keywords that are used for exception handling. So the keywords that are used for exception handling are as follows. Number one is try, cache, finally, throw, throws, and assert. So you cannot use these keywords while writing the names of variables or as an identifier. A part of this, we have keywords for modifiers, which is the access modifiers. For example, we have the access modifier that is public, private, protected, final, abstract, static, native, synchronized, volatile, transient, and strict FP. So you cannot use these keywords, because these keywords are acting as an access modifier. And a part of this access modifiers, you also have the keywords which are class related keywords. For example, class, interface, package, extends, implements, imports. You cannot use these keywords while you're writing the program. And you also have keywords which are related to the object. So that is also called as object related keywords. For example, new, instance of, super, this. So you cannot use these keywords again. And you also have the return type keywords. For example, void is a return type keyword. So you cannot use a void as a name of an identifier. So if your method doesn't return anything, so that is very compulsory that we have to write the return type as void. Now, when you studied the C programming language, you can directly write a method like this, fun, and you are writing integer a something, you are writing the entire functionality of the program. Now, if this method is not returning anything, then it is not necessary that you have to write void here. So in case of C language, it is not at all fixed. It is not at all necessary that you have to write void. But in case of Java, whenever a method is not at all returning anything, now it is compulsory for you that you have to write a void as a return type for that particular method. Now we have unused keywords also. For example, go to, and in the next keyword is const. So const and go to, both these keywords are actually obsolete. We don't use them anymore. Because in case of Java, goto is considered as harmful to use. I'll give you some specific examples later on when I'm going to show you how goto keyword is very harmful in some scenarios, in some cases. That is why they recommended that do not use the goto keyword at all. But in initial versions of Java, the goto keyword was used. A part of this goto keyword, we also have the keyword that is const. And now const keyword is also obsolete because we don't use it anymore. Instead of the const keyword, we use the keyword that is final. So final is the newest recommended word, keyword that we have to use. And we also have the enum keyword. Now this enum keyword is introduced after the Java 1.5. So after the Java 1.5 released, they released the new keyword, that is the enum keyword. We already studied the enum keyword in the C language also. So enum is enumeration types. So for example, you have enum month, so you can name Jan, Feb, March, and so on. In the same way, enum beer, so you can say the different names of the enum. And we have some reserved literals also. As I told you, that there are some reserved literals also, because these are actually given as the values. For example, you can say true, you can say false. For example, if you have a boolean variable, you can say boolean small a is equal to true. Now in this case, now this is a value which can be given to a boolean variable. Either you can give a value as true or you can give a value as false. In the same way, whenever you're writing loops or if else conditions, so either you can give the conditions as true or you can give the conditions as false, and these true and false, both of them are acting as the literals. In the same way, we have null is also used, which is also used as a literal. So null is the default value of the object reference. Null is the default value of an object reference. Now I'm flashing some questions in front of your screen. There are some sample keywords that I've included in the screen. Just look at those sample keywords and tell me which set of the keywords is correct and which set of the keywords is wrong. So which of the following are valid Java reserved words? Option number A is integer, float, signed, double. Option number B, it is abstract, final, volatile, virtual. Option number C is new and delete. Option number D is go to, const, and static. Option number E is byte, short, int, and long. So you have to tell which of the following is valid and which of the following is invalid. So as you can see, in the very first one, we have integer, float, signed, and double. Now here I told you that whenever we give the name of the integer types, so if you go back to the previous PPT here, so you can see the in data types we have byte, short, int, long, float, double, character, and boolean, but we do not have signed. So that is why signed here, because of signed, it is not a valid set of reserved words. The second case is abstract, final, volatile, and virtual. Abstract, final, volatile, and virtual. Now go back to this one where I specified the keywords for modifiers. Here I told you that we have abstract, final, volatile, but we do not have virtual. We do not have virtual. So because of virtual, it is not a set of reserved words. A part of this, you can see in option number C, we have the keyword that is new and delete. Now this new is there because this is object related keyword, but delete is not an object related keyword. And next we have go to, constant, and static. Now here go to we cannot use. So go to is actually a keyword. Static also, it is also a keyword, because you can see keywords for modifier I used keyword which is static, but constant is not there. Const is there, const is there, but constant is not there. Then we have in option number E, we have byte, short, integer, long. All of them are perfectly representing all the Java reserved words. So only in the option number E, all the set that is given as the keyword, they are the correct one. Now whenever we give the reserved words, you can clearly check all the reserved words, they all are written in lowercase letters. There is no reserved word that is written in the uppercase letter. All the reserved words are in the lowercase letters. Okay, I hope that you understood what is a keyword, what is an identifier, and I've given you the list of the keywords and the identifiers. So after this video also, I'll just flash the set of all possible, all the Java keywords and identifiers in front of your screen. Then in the next video, we will look at the data types in Java. So we have the data types as integer, character, float, double, short, even boolean, and even then we have whatever the data types are there. So I'm just going to check out, I'm just going to represent all the data types and their sizes on the data types and the possible values, the possible set of values that you can use in those particular data types. So in case of Java, we use a total of 8 data types. There is, as you can see, they are again categorized into 3 different categories. Number one is the numeric type. The second one is the character type. and the third one is the Boolean type. Now why do we call it as a numeric type? Because they contain the integer values which can be either positive or they can either be negative. But in case of characters, that is just used to represent the characters like small a, small b, capital A, capital B. And we have the Boolean which represents the values which are true or false. Again, these numeric types again divided into two different types, that is the integer types, integer data types which are byte, short, integer and long, because these data types contains the integer values. Then we have floating point data types which are float and double, because these contains the floating point values which are the decimal point values, for example 3.96, 3.48 and so on. So these are the decimal values. And then we have character for which we use char, and then we have Boolean type, that is the Boolean which can contain the values true and false. So we will analyze all these data types one by one. We will look at their size, we will look at the set of values they can use, and we will look at the range of those data types and what are the set of values they can use. For example, here in these integer data types, they contain the negative values in 2's complement representation. I'll take some of these examples of these data types and I'll also show them to you. Okay, so let me just wrap this up and I'll come back to you. Now in case of Java, we have the different data types. We have a total of 8 set of data types which are used in Java. See, when you studied the C language, we mostly used the character, we mostly used the integer, that is int, we used float and we used double. So in case of C language, we were having 4 basic data types, but with these 4 basic data types we used different keywords. For example, we used short for integer, for that we created the short int, then we created the long int, then we created the long long int. In the same way for double, we created the long double and so on. So in case of C, we were having 4 basic data types, and with these 4 basic data types we were adding more keywords to them. Now in case of Java, there are total of 8 basic data types which are categorized into 3 different categories, that is integer, character and the Boolean values. Now integers that may contain the integer values, that is which is negative integer values to the positive integer values. Now characters that contains the characters values, for example small a, small b, small c, to small a to small z. And then we have the capital A, capital B to capital Z, and there are some special characters. And the Boolean data types, again, they can either contain the true or they contain the values which is false. Now, as you can see here, in Java, every variable has a type and every expression has a type. That is why all the types are strictly defined. For example, every variable, if you create any variable whatsoever, see, in case of Python, it is not at all necessary to give the name of the variables, because in Python, that automatically takes the type of the variable by itself. Whenever you assign some value to a variable, it will automatically create whether it is an integer, whether it is a floating point number, whether it is double, or what type of variable it is. That is all already automatically done in Python. But in case of Java, you have to strictly tell what is the type of a variable. That is why in Java, we say that it is a strictly typed language, because for every variable, you have to give the type, as well as for every expression, you have to give the type. Right? Whenever there's some kind of assignments in the expression, you check the types. For example, if you say that we have integer variable integer A and we are giving 3.5. Now, here 3.5 is a double number, but this variable A is an integer variable. Now, whenever you are compiling this program, now this compiler automatically checks the compatibility of these two types and it will return an error. In the same way, in case of Java, whenever you are going to give a float variable, for example, if you do float A is equal to 3.5. Now this will give an error in Java. Why? Because this 3.5 is a double value and you are giving it a floating point variable A. Now in C, if you do this, that is also valid. If you do this, that is also valid. But in C, there is an automatic type conversion. See, again I'm saying, in C language, there is an automatic type conversion. Automatic type conversion. For example, here if you write this this expression in C language, now this 3.5 is automatically converted to a floating point number. This 3.5 is automatically converted to an integer number. But in case of Java, it cannot be automatically converted. It will return an error that there's a wrong type declaration that you have done, or in this expression there's different data types that is given to a floating point number, so there might be some kind of loss of precision, there might be some kind of loss of data. So that is why Java is called as a strictly defined language, or you can say strictly typed language. So all the assignments are checked by the compiler for the compatibility purposes, whether the assignments is compatible or not. For example, in this particular case, 3.5 is a double number and you are assigning it to 14 point variable A. So it will be checked for the compatibility, whether it is this variable A is compatible to take this expression or not. That is why the Java is a strongly typed language. Python is not a strongly typed language. Even we do not consider C language also as a strongly typed language, because in case of C language, there is automatic type conversion also, right? Then the Java even contains non-object primitive data types, non-objective primitive data types. There are data types that are object data types. See, data types we categorize them into two different categories. Number one is primitive, second one is user defined. Primitive that are defined internally. For example, here you can see this integer, character, float, byte, short, long, character, boolean, these are the primitive data types. But there may be some data types that is defined by the user. So in case of C, we do it by creating structures, that is structures are user defined data types. But in case of Java, we do it with the help of classes. So we create objects of a class, that is the instance of a particular data type, where the class acts as a data type and so on. So we'll discuss that in a later point of time, but just understand that Java even contains non-object primitive data types that I'll share with you in later point of time. And except Boolean and character, all the data types are signed data types. Signed means they may be having positive values as well as they may be having negative values. So for example, here this byte, short, int, long, double and float. So all these are might be having a positive value, they might be having a negative value, and the negative values are generally denoted by the 2's complement representation. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll explain you each and every data type, whether it is integer, whether it is short, whether it is byte, whether it is long or double or float. I'll take each of these data types one by one, and with that I'll also define what is the size of the data types. Second, according to the size, what is the range of the data types, because we use 2's complement, how does it affect the range, and what is the example that how can you give expressions or values according to that. And then I'm going to cover that conversion of one data type to another. For example, you can store a byte data type to short, but you cannot store a short to byte. If you do it, it is allowed if you do it, but then there will be loss of some data or there will be loss of some precision. In the same way, you can store a byte data type to integer, but you cannot store an integer data type to byte, because there will be some loss of data, because size of byte is smaller, size of integer is larger. In the same way, if you take a character data type, you can store a character into an integer, but then when you will store an integer to a character, it might lead you to some kind of warnings that we will see. And in the same way, there may be some interchanging, that one kind of data type can be stored in another type kind of data type can be stored in another, and so on. We will discuss that one by one. So just now you write in your notebook that what are the different types of data type, that is primitive. In case of primitive, we have numeric, we have character, we have boolean, and then we have these four are the integer types, these two are the floating point type. And let me take in the next video all these data types one by one, and I'll also define you what is the limit, what is the minimum value that you can store, and what is the maximum value you can store, and also write you and also show you the same with the help of a program. Okay. Now in this video, let us take all the data types one by one, and I'll also define you what is the range of that particular data type and what are the values that you can store. For example, as I told you, in case of integer data types, data types that can store integers, we were having number one, we have byte, then second one we have short, the third one we have integer, that is int, and the fourth one we have long. So we'll take them one by one. The very first data type that I'm discussing is the byte as a data type. Okay. So generally, actually, I'm writing it as a capital B, but when you create a variable of this byte data type, it will be created by using the small b. So for example, I can say I have byte byte himu, which is storing the value 9. Now, what is the difference between all these data types? The difference is actually in their size. For example, here this byte data type is of 1 byte only. The second is short, which is of 2 bytes. The third is integer, which is of 4 bytes. And the fourth is long, which is again of 8 bytes. Now all these data types uses 2's complement to represent the negative number. So they use 2's complement representation to represent the negative numbers. Now again, as you see, the byte here, it is of 8 bit, again 8 bits. And with the help of 8 bits, you can represent the negative numbers also, right? We have minus negative numbers and we have positive numbers. Now, with the help of these 8 bits, when we are using the 2's complement, guys, if you don't know what is a 2's complement, I suggest you that you go back to our videos in digital logic or in computer architecture number system topic. In case of number system topic, I explained you what is a 2's complement, what is a 1's complement, and what is a sign bit representation. What is the difference between all these representations? So here we need 2's complement representation. Now, because we are using a 2's complement representation and there are 8 bits, so what is the negative number that we are using? So the negative numbers will be minus 2 raised to power 7 to the positive number will be plus 2 raised to power 7 minus 1. So that means the minimum number that we can store is minus 127, 28 to maximum number, that is plus 127. Okay. So this is the range of the numbers that we can store in a byte. Now, for example, if I say I have a variable which is byte A is equal to 9, that is perfectly fine because this number 9 comes between this range. If I write byte A is equal to minus 128, that is also perfectly fine because that is coming under this range. If I write byte A is equal to 128, now this is not correct because this will lead to a compile time error. Why it will lead to a compile time error? Because it is not in this particular range. So that is why you will get a compile time error in your program. Now, as you can see the screen in front of you, so here I just listed down all the things that I have written, and here the compile time error that we are going to get, that will say the possible loss of precision. It will get say the possible loss of precision. Now, if I say we have byte A is equal to true, if I write byte A is equal to true, now in this case also you will get a compile time error, because in this case it will say that if you write byte A is equal to true, then there is a compile time error. It will say that you are storing a different type of data in an integer type. For example, here the type compatibility is not correct. The type is boolean, but you are storing that boolean variable in case of an integer variable. So you will get incompatible type found, which is boolean, but the required type is byte. And this byte data type is best suitable for handling data that is either from file or in the form of network, because it is very short. The next data type here is the short data type. In case of short, as I told you, the size is 2 bytes. Now, because the size is 2 bytes, so the minimum number that you can store, 2 bytes means it is 16 bits. Therefore, the minimum number that you can store in case of short as a data type, that will be minus 2 raised to power 15 to plus 2 raised to power 15 minus 1. Minus 2 raised to power 15 to plus 2 raised to power 15 minus 1, which is minus 32768 to plus 32767. So this is the range. Again, if I try to store a number within this range, that is perfectly fine. But if I try to store a number which is outside this range, then we'll get a compile time error saying that possible loss of precision, because that number is out of the range of this particular type. Okay. So if I say I do short, if I create a variable that is short t is equal to 2. Now that will again lead to a compile time error, because it will say that we needed an integer variable, but you are giving us a boolean type, right? So the best short is best suitable data type for 16 bit processes. Okay, but the next data type here is the integer as a data type. So as you can see, the size of the integer is actually 4 bytes. Now, size of the integer is 4 bytes, therefore the minimum number that we can store is minus 2 raised to power 31
2, the maximum number that we can store is plus 2 raised to power 31 minus 1.
And what is this precise value? I have written it down. So this precise value here is minus 21474836648, and the positive value is minus 2 plus 21474836647. So this is the largest value and the smallest value that you can store in integer data types. So generally we use integer data type very frequently. Then we have the next data type, that is long. Again, the size of long is 8 bytes. 8 byte means it is 32 bits. Sorry, it is 64 bits. So this is 32 bits. So because it is 64 bit, therefore the minimum value that we can store is minus 2 raised to power 63 to plus 2 raised to power 63 minus 1. So generally, whenever we have specific size here and we are using 2's complement, let us say this is a very golden, very general rule. Let us say any variable is of n bits. For example, here this is of 64 bits, this is 32 bits, this is 16 bits, and this is 8 bits. So if a variable is of n bits, then the minimum number that we can store is minus 2 raised to power n minus 1 to the maximum number that we can store is plus 2 raised to power n minus 1 minus 1. So again here, minus 2 raised to power n minus 1 to plus 2 raised to power n minus 1 minus 1. In the same way, minus 2 raised to power n minus 1 to plus 2 raised to power n minus 1 minus 1. Again, minus 2 raised to power n minus 1 to plus 2 raised to power n minus 1 minus 1. This way you can specify what is the minimum number that can be stored in a 2's complement variable. In the same way, what is the minimum number that can be stored in a and what is the maximum number that can be stored in a 2's complement variable. Okay, now the next data type here is the floating point data type and the boolean data type. So let me just come back to the next video and I'll show you what is the range of the floating point data type and what is the range of a boolean data type. So the next data type is the floating point data type. Again, there are two types here in floating point. Number one is a float and the second one is a double. Now, in case of floating point, the float is of 4 bytes and the double is of 8 bytes, and we generally use float in the cases when we need single precision. So we have already studied the IEEE format here in the floating point data types. I think you must have studied that in the number system topic in digital logic. You can go back to this video and you can check out the details about the floating point type, how the floating point numbers are represented. But as you can see here, in the floating point type, it is a 4 byte number and the range is minus 3.4E38 to 3.4E38, and this is the positive number, this is a negative number, and we use the float number whenever we need precision which is up to 6 to 7 decimal numbers. But in case of double, we use the double whenever we need the precision which is up to 14 to 15 decimal numbers, and it is also called as the double precision type. It is very similar whatever we have studied in the C language, because again in the C language also the size of float is of 4 bytes and the size of double is of 8 bytes. The only difference between the C language and in the case of Java is the number of variables, the number of data types that we have here in Java, and secondly the size of those data types. For example, there are various versions of C language. The previous versions that we used, where we used the Turbo C++, and the Turbo C, there the size of integer is of 2 bytes. But when we compile the C program in the code blocks or the latest compilers that can be codebooks or Dev C++ and so on, so in those compilers the size of C is actually of 4 bytes. So size of C, size of integer is of 4 bytes. The size of integer is actually varied. So size of integer in C language, it can be a 2 byte, it can be 4 bytes. But in case of Java, the size of integer is actually fixed. It is only a 4 byte. That is why in the same way, the size of different types of variables are also fixed. Now you can see what is the range of a double data types here. And I think we have already covered some of the examples regarding the point numbers that you can store in case of double. Now there's one more thing that is worth mentioning here. If you create a variable like this in case of Java, if I create float A is equal to 3.56. Now writing this statement, whenever you write this statement in C language, now in the C language it is perfectly fine, it is perfectly valid, because in C we use automatic type conversion.
But in case of Java, we don't have an automatic type conversion. Whenever you are going to write this one, now you are going to get a compile time error and it is not at all allowed. But in case of Java, whenever you have to give a value to a floating point variable, you have to write float a is equal to 3.56f. Now, if you write f value with it, it is automatically specifying that it is a floating point variable. Now, because it is a floating point variable, so it is perfectly fine in C as well as it is also perfectly fine in Java. And in case of double, you can write a is equal to 3.56. That is also perfectly fine in both the languages. If I write double, a is equal to 3.56f, that is also fine in both the languages. The reason is, whenever you are not specifying f with it, that means it is a double variable. If I am writing float a is equal to 3.56, this variable, this value by default, it is a double value. Now, because C language supports an automatic type conversion, again, Java is not having any automatic type conversion, C is having automatic type conversion. That is the reason why whenever you are just specifying this, now in case of C, it is automatically converted to a float value. But in case of Java, you have to specify that this value is not a double value, this value is a float value. That is why it is necessary, or you can say it is compulsory, to write f with it. So if you write float a is equal to 3.56f, that is fine in C language, that is fine in Java, because it is considering that this value is a, by default, this value is a float value. Now here I am not writing f with it, that means this value is a double value, and here I am writing f with it, that means it is a float value. Now as you can see, here the size of float is 4 byte and the size of double is 8 byte. That means every number that you can write in float, that can be stored inside a double variable. But any number that you write in double, that cannot be stored inside a float variable, because there will be some kind of loss of precision. Therefore, your compile time error you are going to get, and you are going to get a warning saying that there will be loss of precision. Now this is a very famous example, that very simple example that I've already taken. Now in let us say you have an integer variable, integer a is equal to 3.56. Okay. Now this program I'm writing in C language. Okay. So with every statement, I'm showing you the correlation between the Java as well as the C programming language. And here this program is, I'm writing in C language. If I'm writing, if a is equal to 3.56, then printf high, else printf by, Now if I write the program like this, now you can clearly see here that in C language also, it will not print high, it will print by. This high will not be printed. Why? Because this variable a, actually I should write like this, float a. So because this variable a here is of floating point type, and this point 3.56 is of double type. So because it is a floating point type variable, 3.56 is by default is stored as a float, and here comparing a float variable to a double variable. That is why even in case of C language, this printf high will not be printed, printf by will be printed. In the same way, whenever you compare them in Java, so in case of Java, this is a float variable, this is a double variable. Again, you cannot compare a float variable and double variable. Again, you are going to get some kind of errors or some kind of warnings with it. Okay. So that is why we use two different types here, there is float and the double. And double we used for when we need multiple, more precision, which is of 14 to 15 decimal places. Apart from this, we can have a boolean as a data type. Now the size of the boolean as a data type, that is not applicable here, because that is dependent on your virtual machine, that is a Java virtual machine. See, I told you the size of integer, I told you the size of byte, I told you the size of character and all these things, but I never told you the size of the boolean as a data type. Now this boolean as a data type, it contains only two values, that is true and false. But that does not mean that these two values are 0s and 1. Clearly I'm saying, see, this is very simply I can show you this thing with an example. Let us say, this is in case of C language. Okay, in case of C language, if you write if condition, if 0, okay, or you write if 1, right? In case of C language, every expression, whenever it is true or whenever it is false, it is having some values. If an expression is true, that means it is going to return a value 1. If an expression is false, that means it is going to return a value 0, or it is going to return a value which is null.
Now null and zero are considered as false. One or any value which is other than zero, that is considered as a true in C language. But that does not happen in Java. In case of Java, if an expression is true, it does not mean that the value is 1. If an expression is false, it does not mean that the value is true. For example, if you write a statement like this in C language, that is integer a is equal to 5 less than 6, like this. Now this expression is completely valid in case of C language, because this expression will return a value 1 to this, and 1 will be stored in this integer variable a. But this expression is not at all valid in Java, because here you say integer a is equal to 5 less than 6. Now this will return either true or it will return as false. Now here it will return as true, but true is not an integer data type. It is not an integer value. Again, I'm saying true is not an integer value. It is a literal value. Now because it is a literal value, therefore if you store this literal value to an integer variable a, integer literal value is not at all integer, right? So it will again give you a compile time error by saying there's two different types here. I was expecting integer, but you are giving me a literal, that is true. So this is not at all allowed. So that is why the boolean data types are required here, and it is completely different as compared to whatever we have done in C language. The next data type here is character alphabets. For the character data type, that is using the character alphabets. In case of C, we were using the ASCII codes. In case of C++ also, we were using the ASCII codes. And the size of character in C and C++ is of 1 byte. But here in Java, the size of character is of 2 bytes. 2 byte means it can store 2 raised to power, see, 2 bytes means it can store 2 raised to power 16 different characters. Different characters. Again, here in case of characters, I never told you whether it is signed or unsigned, because signed and unsigned concept is not at all valid for characters. The only concept that is valid here is the number of different symbols that you can store in a character as a data type. Now you can see the size is of 2 bytes. The size of character is of 2 bytes. 2 bytes means it can store 2 raised to power different symbols. And these symbols are actually stored in the form of Unicode. These symbols are stored in the form of Unicode. Unicode means these are so many characters that every language in the world that we generally use, we can represent every symbol of those languages in these characters. For example, in ASCII code, we were having only English characters, that is small a to small z, capital A to capital Z, and some special symbols. But here in case of Java, we support Chinese, that is Mandarin. We support Hindi, we support Tamil, we support even, you know, characters from all the different languages. We support them in case of Java, because the number of symbols that you can represent here are way too more as compared to the previous programming languages, and that is why it is very popular here. But you should know what is the range of the symbols, what is the range of the Unicode values that is assigned to a particular character type. Okay. Now let me do one thing. Let me just rub the screen, and I'll create a table here for all the data types possible, and I'll show you what is the range of each and every data type in a table itself. Just do one thing. Just watch in front of your screen. I've already given a table here. The byte, the size of byte, the range, the default values, and the wrapper classes. Okay. I'll discuss about this wrapper class whenever in later point of time, because right now I just want to introduce you with the primitive data types. But till now I never introduced you the classes, and I never introduced you what is the concept of wrapper class. Now you can see here we have the data types byte, short, int, long, float, double, boolean, and characters. And you can see the sizes of each and every data types. You can see the range. You can see the default values. That means whenever you are not going to give any values, what is the default values they are going to have? And you can see the wrapper class. Now take this table and write it down in your notebook, because that is going to help you in understanding the later concepts. And after this, let me take a few examples of this integer literals and the other concepts. Okay.